also like to make mention of any new members today joining us for the first time. Please do feel welcome. We have a special theme today, a very, very timely theme in the times that we are living in and much, much needed, where we face daily reports of loss, grief, and hurt. And so today our theme is dealing with grief. And our special speaker for the day, Sister Moureen Ngwenya. And once again, we know the Lord will bless her words to our hearts, and we will leave you feeling strengthened and encouraged. Sister Moureen Ngwenya, thank you so much for once again availing yourself, and I pray that the Lord will bless you. Thank you so much. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sister Belinda. May the Lord bless you and your ministry as well. Thank you for this song you were reading, you were singing. Thank you very much. Yes. I'd like to thank the Lord for this platform. The month of August has been an amazing time for me as we fellowshipped together. And I want to say this is an amazing ministry. And today is my last day on this platform as a contributor, but I want to tell you I'll stay in the room for so many reasons. I have benefited a lot from the messages that were shared and also from the experiences that I had in the breakaway prayer rooms. So today is I was looking for a message to conclude this series, and you know there are so many beautiful passages in the Word of God. And it seems like almost every word of God is meant to comfort us, to strengthen us. And I am very humbled by how God has led us this far, because just his name is a strong tower and the righteous who run to it are safe. Our safety in these closing hours is in his word. And as we look at the events that are befalling the world, our hearts, you know, melt with fear, with uncertainty. But the word of God is steadfast. And if we stand on the word, the Lord has promised that he will see us through. He says our position is just to stand and let the Lord do his thing. Our passage, I have so many passages, so I cannot say our passage of consideration, but my first text is going to come from the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 4, verses 16 to 18. I will read in your hearing. So we do not lose heart, though our outer man is wasting away. Our inner man is being renewed day by day. For this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory and beyond all comparison. As we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are seen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Shall we pray? Eternal Father, we thank you this morning for waking us up once again to hear your word. You are the wisdom behind everything that we need, behind everything that we know and that we are. And we thank you for inviting us to the throne of grace this morning. We pray that you may meet each and every one of us at our real point of need. I pray and ask all this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. The text that we just read, the Apostle Paul says, we, because of the things that we are going through, if the Lord had not been on our side, who would have perished? Can you go back and think of the times when you were sick? If the Lord had not been our God, who would have died? If when the time when we lost our loved ones, we would have died by just losing. The way our hearts broke when we lost our loved ones, we would have just died. You know, all the things that we've gone through that threatened to kill us. But the Lord is faithful. So he says, whilst we are having all these pressures, we are not consumed we continue. I'd like to use the words that he used here. He says, whilst our nature is wasting away, our inner man is being renewed, and we are being renewed by his word. Day by day, even in this prayer room, every day we are being renewed. For this light, and God calls our afflictions a slight and momentary afflictions. But then he goes on to say, the glory that awaits us, the glory that awaits us far outweighs whatever. There's nothing to compare with the pain that we are going through. The Lord says, what awaits us at the end of this journey far outweighs all that we are going through. He says, may we not look. Because it says, look not to the things that are seen, which means what we are going through is evident. Our pain is real. It's not a theory, it's real. But it says, do not look to the physical. Look to the things that are unseen, which means we need to exercise our faith. We need to look beyond our pain. Our pain, when we stay focused on our pain, it has the ability, do you know? As human beings, we think in pictures. Now, when we look to the things that are seen or the things that were like yesterday, those things have the power to kill us. They have the power to kill even our hope. But as we look to the things that are unseen, we continue to look at God's word, where we know that even this too shall come to pass. The song that was playing just before we came on was saying, tears are a language that God understands. And our God understands perfectly well what we are going through. Because the world, our lot was cast in the closing hours of this world. You and I, you know, I always used to say to myself, but why did God allow Daniel and the likes of Paul to go ahead of us? Why these people should have been living in these hours, because they were much stronger than we are. But the glory, the power is not ours. The power belongs to him who has called us to run in the closing hours of this world. If you look at this race, it was run by people who are like Abraham, of whom God required of whom God gave a request that he never gave to any man, for him to sacrifice his son. And the pen of inspiration actually says, when Abraham on that mount, he actually killed in his mind, Isaac was dead. And you can imagine the brokenness in his heart. God requested that thing of Abraham. And not only that, there were maintainers in between, all the people that we know who went through anything, any storm of life. Some even lost their lives. Why? Because this race is a race of endurance. And we are also running. We have been put in the race, but the strength is not ours. The strength is of him who has promised to walk with us. And he says our momentary afflictions are a work that one day we are going to celebrate and say, Lord, thank you for allowing us to go through all that you've allowed us to go through. I always say, how would we know that the Lord is a comforter if we've not gone through any pain? How would we know that he is a provider if we've never lacked? How would we know that the Lord heals if we've never fallen sick? Even in this situation, when we are continuously losing, the Lord has promised that he is right there with us, strengthening each and every one of us. And as we march onward, our march is onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war. We should never give up. And in this great war, where everyone, almost every day, we are receiving news of loss, the Lord is saying we are going to be victorious as we march forward together. And we need to look everywhere and see if there are any casualties, if there's anyone who is failing to run this race, and we hold hands and walk on and march on together. Just after we got married, my husband joined the Air Force of Zimbabwe. And when he joined the Air Force of Zimbabwe, he was a civilian. And he went in the Air Force for quite some time before he went for his military training. And he kind of seemed like to be enjoying his new job. And then a few months down the line, they were now sent away for military training. And you know, the men who went for military training and the men who came back seemed totally different. My husband, when he came back, when he went, he was a civilian, this kind of guy who did things in a certain manner. But when he came, he was organized. He had gone through some training, some rigorous training. And one of the things that he told me that as he was, as the first thing that happened the day that they arrived on camp was, they were in a bus, all the untrained soldiers who were going for training, they were in a bus, and 10 kilometers before their training camp, the bus driver just said, everyone get off. And remember, this, the bus driver is a soldier, everyone on the bus is a soldier, but the only trained person right there was the driver. And then he said, everyone take your luggage, and they were carrying their 5 kg backpack and a rifle. They were carrying, they were wearing these new clothes that they were not used to, the heavy the soldiers wear. And he says they were then asked to finish the remaining 10 kilometers on foot, and they were supposed to run to the camp. My husband, being the athletic guy that he was, outran everyone, and he got to the camp. When he got there, there were soldiers, the trainers were waiting for them. And he said the moment he got there, he was expecting to be applauded and things. And these guys just started torturing him. They rolled him, they beat him, they asked him to roll on sand, they poured water on him, they tortured him. And he kept asking, what is happening, guys? And in his civilian language, he was asking what was happening. And no one answered a thing. They kept doing their thing until the last soldier arrived. And then they said, okay, young man, here is the first lesson in the army, that you never run alone. In the army, we run as a unit. You don't get accolades for winning a race in a war. In a war, we win together, we lose together. If you are running with as a unit and one of you is tired, you carry their backpack. Even if after carrying their backpack, they are still tired, you take their rifle. If they are still tired and they cannot still go on their own, you carry them and you arrive as a unit. And I'm saying, in this war, as Christian soldiers, our race is not to run, to outrun each other, but we hold hands in this situation. Hold hands, look out for the next person. Where are they? How are they coping? It's not a selfish war where each and everyone is working out their salvation with fear and trembling and forgetting their brethren. This is the time where we look out for others, where we shout, where we lift. Remember when the children of Israel went to war every time, the children of Issachar would not carry any weapons, they would carry flags. And when they went to war, if there was a part of the way, if war was hot in any area, they would lift a flag to ask for help. And I'm saying there are people who are wallowing in pain. Some only what they need is a phone call. And the church is asleep, is not being relevant in this season where people are bleeding and not finding anywhere to hold. And I'm saying, as we look at this situation, at the brokenness all around us, it calls for each and every one of us to do a work, to hold hands, to look out for each other and to check up on each other. Just the other day, as I was, I think I mentioned earlier on that I have a group of young widows that I'm ministering to. And actually on Sunday, we are having a lunch for these widows who lost their husbands between last year and this year. And one of the ladies said, I just want to give a testimony. And I thought it was a testimony of how the Lord had made a victorious in a widow journey. And she says, you know what? When I lost my husband, she's actually there in South Africa. She says, when I lost my husband, no one from the church asked me how I was doing. No one even phoned me. And I ended up going to clubs. The people from the clubs, my friends from my clubbing friends, came and were around me. And, you know, I ended up just doing all sorts. I had no one to turn to. I had no one to phone me. But I'm saying there's something we can do. There's something we can all do, because the Lord has called us Christian soldiers, because there's a way that soldiers do things that we as his children now also ought to do things, and not just watch or even take behind. I'm also talking to those who have lost, because if you have lost, God has called you to a ministry. He says, whatever you've gone through, look not to those things, because they have a way of weighing you down. But you need to continue marching, even if it means crawling. Keep moving forward. Keep going. Do not stop moving, because once you stop moving, the devil will destroy you in that place. And at the end of the journey, like I will tell you the story, I was telling the story of my husband. At the end of those 6 months after military training, there was a pass-out parade. And in that pass-out parade, all the soldiers, after all that rigorous training, they were being awarded for staying strong. Some were being awarded for being able to be leaders for so many different reasons. And I'm saying, at the end of our journey, God has promised that he will say, welcome. Actually, the book of Revelation gives us a picture of us in heaven. After all this, and the Bible actually says, these are they that came from great tribulation. And these are the tribulations that we are going through. If we only hold hands and march on together, there is a day that is waiting for us. And God says, there is a day that is going to wipe away all tears. There's no more pain, no more separation, no more sickness, no more death. That's the place that we are waiting for. And as we march on, we'll find your place in the Bible. Find your place in the Bible. Strengthen each other. Every text in the Bible is God's word, and God's word is God himself strengthening us. We might not have everything in the Bible, but whatever we get, God is going to use us to help us as ammunition against the devil. And I want to encourage someone this morning to say, even as we are going through these painful situations, the Lord has said, there is a glory that awaits us, and the hidden wisdom of God is helping us to move, to navigate, to navigate in the bullets of this world, as the world is, you know,